Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Salam.
Alhamdulillah, puji syukur kita panjatkan karena berkat rahmat Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, kita bisa berkumpul bersama menimba ilmu dari narasumber kita yang dilaksanakan secara online. Semoga kita tetap dalam kondisi yang sehat dan selalu dalam perlindungan Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala dari segala macam penyakit. Fresh and gratitude, we pray, thanks to the grace of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, we can gather together to learn from the speaker. May Allah, may we always stay in good health and always in protection of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala from all kind of disease. Acara ini merupakan acara lecture series yang dilaksanakan oleh Departemen Kesehatan Lingkungan Fakultas Kesehatan Masyarakat Universitas Airlangga dalam rangka pelaksanaan Public Health Airlangga University Summer School. This event is lecture series held by Department of Environmental Health Faculty of Public Health Universitas Airlangga in the context of implementing Public Health Airlangga University Summer School. Selamat datang kepada para peserta dan selamat bergabung di acara lecture series dengan tema Management of Environmental Health in Settlement and Public Places. Good morning, participant, and welcome to the lecture series with the theme is Management of Environmental Health in Settlement and Public Places. Untuk hari ini, narasumber kita adalah Prof. Sarva Mangala Pravena, BSc, MSc, PhD. Today, our speaker is Ms. Prof. Sarva Mangala Pravena, BSc, MSc, PhD. Lalu, perkenalkan, nama saya Rusda dan rekan saya Teresia. Kami mahasiswa S1 Kesehatan Masyarakat, Peminatan Kesehatan Lingkungan, Fakultas Kesehatan Masyarakat, Universitas Airlangga. Let me introduce myself. My name is Rusda. My friend is Teresia. We are an undergraduate students of Public Health, specializing in Environmental Health Faculty of Public Health, Universitas Airlangga.
Selamat pagi, salam sejahtera untuk kita semua. Terima kasih banyak Bapak Ibu telah hadir di acara lecture series hari ini. Good mornings and greetings to all of us. Thank you ladies and gentlemen for attending today's lecture series. Terima kasih dan selamat datang kami ucapkan kepada Pak Trias beserta tim selaku Wakil Dekan 3 FKM UNER, Kepala Departemen Kesehatan Lingkungan, Koordinator Program Studi Magister Kesehatan Lingkungan, dan Fakulti Ambassador FKM UNER. We would like to greet and welcoming our Deputy Dean Faculty, Mr. Trias and team, Chief of Environmental Health Department, and Fakulti Ambassador of Public Health. Kami ucapkan selamat pagi juga dan selamat datang kepada Miss Associate Professor Sarva Mangala Pravena, BSc, MSc, PhD, sebagai narasumber pada hari ini dengan materi Microplastic Pollution in Residential Area. We would like to greet Miss Associate Prof. Sarva Mangala Pravena, BSc, MSc, PhD, as our speaker for today's topic, Microplastic Pollution in Residential Area. Good morning, Miss Pravena. Thank you for joining us today. Kami juga ucapkan selamat datang dan selamat bergabung kepada Bapak-Ibu dosen Fakultas Kesehatan Masyarakat Universitas Airlangga. And we welcome to the lectures of Public Health Faculty University of Airlangga who joined us today. Baiklah, sebelum memulai acara, saya akan membacakan susunan lecture series pada hari ini. In today's lecture series, we have four sections. Cara pertama adalah pembukaan dengan berdoa. First, we start with opening prayer. Kemudian acara kedua adalah sambutan sekaligus pembukaan oleh Pak Tria selaku Wakil Dekan 3 Fakultas Kesehatan Masyarakat. Second, we have greeting and also opening ceremony by our Deputy Dean of Faculty of Public Health, Mr. Trias Mahmudiono. Acara ketiga yaitu adalah pemaparan materi dengan judul Microplastic Pollution in Residential Area, sekaligus diskusi dan juga tanya-jawab. Third, we have course from Ms. Pravena according to today's topic, microplastic pollution in residential area, and continue with the question and answer section. Acara keempat yaitu adalah penutup dan juga pembacaan doa penutup. And for the last one, we will have a closing and a closing prayer. Untuk mengefisiensikan waktu, langsung saja kita masuk ke cara pertama, yakni berdoa. And let's begin today's lecture series with a prayer.
Rabbi shrahli sadri wa yassir li amri wahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. memasuki agenda selanjutnya, yakni sambutan dan pembukaan dari Wakil Dekan 3 Fakultas Kesehatan Masyarakat Universitas Airlangga kepada Bapak Trias Mahmudiono. Waktu dan layar kami persilakan. Entering the next agenda, opening by Deputy Dean of Faculty of Public Health to Mr. Trias Mahmudiono, we welcome the time and the screen.
Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, everybody.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam, Pak.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome and thank you for the attendance in the Faculty of Public Health Summer School lecture series from the Department of Environmental Health. With the topic today is about microplastic pollution in residential areas. Honorable guest lecturer, Associate Professor Sarva Mangala Ravina, PhD from the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health, Faculty of Medicine and Health Science, University of Putra Malaysia. Thank you very much, Prof, for your time to share your knowledge with us, with the student in the summer course that we have, and also our adjunct professors and colleague, Professor Juliana. Thank you for the attention and support for us in Faculty of Public Health. Honorable Head of the Department of Environmental Health, Dr. Lilis Sulistiorini, and also Ibu Dr. Aziza as a coordinator of Master Study Program in Environmental Health, and also the student of Public Health, undergraduate student and master student that are having the specification in environmental health. First of all, let us pray to Allah that give us health and also time to spare to learn with our colleague from Malaysia related to a very important matter related to microplastic pollution in residential area. As we know that environmental health management of settlement and public places discusses the arrangement in an effort to obtain ecological balance between human and residential environment. We know that we produce a lot of waste from plastic waste, also waste from the excretion of the animals, including ourselves, that also going to affect the environment. How can we make ourselves and also our surrounding to have access to, for example, safe and clean water despite the waste that we have. Hence, I think microplastic contamination is unavoidable, but we need to strive how to prevent those to manage the microplastic waste so it's not going to affect a human. And I think what we're going to learn today is very important. And I know that in the Department of Environmental Health, we also have some expert, including Dr. Lilis and maybe some other lecturer who currently undergoing doctoral study program, maybe wants to continue collaboration with our colleague, Dr. Ravina or Prof. Juliana and others, to make an effort related to join research or join publication in the future about this topic. Because in Indonesia, we know a couple of months ago, we know that in Sidoarjo and Surabaya, we have a case of microplastic that was leak, and it was found in egg, if I'm not mistaken. There was something very dangerous because many of the children in Indonesia are still stunted, and one of the campaign is to improve the consumption of egg. But when the egg was contaminated, then it's also dangerous. So we have to make a good management about this. I think we're going to learn a lot with Dr. Ravina. Thank you very much. And We hope the student is going to be inspired by the lecture. Don't be shy to ask question, to raise your hand, because this is a rare opportunity that we have expert from our neighboring countries. I think on behalf of the faculty and also the dean, we thank all the speakers today and also our colleague. And please have a fruitful lecture and discussion later on. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih Pak Trias telah memberikan sambutan. Thank you for Mr. Trias who has given a speech. Baik, selanjutnya kita masuk dalam acara inti, yaitu pemaparan materi sekaligus diskusi dan tanya-jawab oleh narasumber, di mana nanti akan dipandu secara langsung oleh rekan saya, Mas Azmi, seorang Magister Kesehatan Lingkungan, Fakultas Kesehatan Masyarakat, Universitas Airlangga. Selaku moderator, kepada Mas Azmi, kami persilakan untuk langsung memandu pemaparan materi dan diskusi. We will enter the presentation of the materials, as well as discussion, question, and answer by the speaker, which will be guided by Muhammad Azmi Ma'ruf, an undergraduate student of Environmental Health Master Program, Faculty of Public Health, Universitas Airlangga, as a moderator. To Muhammad Azmi Ma'ruf, we welcome the time and the screen.
Thank you so much, MC, for the opportunity. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Perkenalkan kembali, saya Muhammad Azmi Ma'ruf, mahasiswa Magister Kesehatan Lingkungan, Fakultas Kesehatan Masyarakat Universitas Erlangga. At this time, we'll try to moderate the show, which was in this session. We would like to hear from Associate Professor Sarva Mangala Pravina, BSc, MSc, PhD, from Department of Environmental and Occupational Health Faculty of Medicine and Health Science, University Putra Malaysia. With the topics of microplastics pollution in residential area. But first, let me share a brief CV about our speaker today. So let me share my screen first. Okay. This Sarva Mangala Pravina, BSc, MSc, PhD. The current position is Associate Professor at the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health, Faculty of Medicine and Health Science, University Putra Malaysia. Her academic career started off as a demonstrator, start from 2002, research assistant, postdoctoral fellow, senior lecturer, and the current position is a research professor at Faculty of Medicine and Health Science.
Oh, alhamdulillah. Gak capek kak kawan. Enggak, kayaknya dia memang berharap banget dapat itu.
She gets a lot of awards and recognition alongside of her career and a lot of research grant. 13 yeah. times as a project leader and 11 times as a co-member. With H index and Scopus is 23 and Google Scholar H index is 32. So now, before the speaker started to explain the information today, we would like to ask you if you want to ask the question, you can ask at the option chat in the format.
Dia belum ngasih tawaran.
With the start of your university institution, and also write down the question. Next, we would like to give Ms. Sarva Mangala Pravina to present the presentation. Screen and silence.
Thank you, Muhammad Azmi. And good morning, everyone. So I'll be sharing my screen. For a while, yeah, I'm sharing my screen. Mm.
Do you need help? Miss Pravina?
No. My setting. Okay. All right. You can see my screen, right?
Yes, we can see it.
Yeah. Clear? Can you see the screen?
Right now, it's just a picture of the landscape. Your wallpaper. We didn't see the presentation.
Oh, you can see the screen? Dr. Zida, can you see the screen?
Yeah, we see. From my screen, I see coastal area. Is it?
It's the title.
We only see the wallpaper of your
not
computer.
Yet, miss.
Let me try it again.
Okay. It's the same. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, can you see now?
Yes.
Oh, right. Thank God. Okay. Good morning again, everyone. My name is Sarah Mangla Pravina. I'm from Department of Environmental and Occupational Health, Faculty of Medicine and Health Sciences, University Putra Malaysia. I do have my boss here, Prof. Juliana, and my other colleague of mine, Dr. Nur Faseha. Okay, and before I start, I would like to thank Department of Environmental Health, Faculty of Public Health, Universitas Airlangga, for this opportunity, with a special thanks to Dr. Lilis and Dr. Zida for this. Okay, so we can start now. All right, the outline will be covered from microplastic pollution. We will try to understand what is microplastic pollution all about. And then we will move on to understand microplastic characteristic, means what are the things of microplastic that importantly you will need to know. And then part three, I'll be sharing few of case studies from my team, my students, those findings from residential areas. I think that could be very relatable to any one of us, doesn't matter we are from Indonesia or Malaysia. And then we have some activities for you to understand better on microplastic that comes from residential area. And part fifth part is the end, end of this lecture. All right, so before we go on, we will see the global view of plastic waste produced and mismanaged. If you see globally, everybody produce plastic waste, it doesn't matter whether we are from developed or underdeveloped or developing countries. But what matters is that the portion of plastic waste that being mismanaged. If you see, there is a big difference between developed country and underdeveloped or developing country. If you see the European countries, they well manage the plastic waste compared to Asia. And very sadly, except for Japan, South Korea, Thailand, and Hong Kong, most of Southeast Asian countries, we do have a huge portion of plastic waste which is mismanaged, and very little of our plastic waste is actually well managed. This is the very sad part. But put that aside, what matters here is the portion of plastic waste that is mismanaged now could be a big problem in 10 to 15 years later. So we need to do something from our residential area so that a meaningful step from us can give a big impact later on. All right, and then we move on. We will learn about the lifestyle of microplastic before we go a bit deep. If you see the lifestyle of microplastic, the plastic that being produced in land, as a life cycle, the plastic will break down, go into a smaller version, and it will enter to aquatic environment. In aquatic environment, okay, recent studies have shown that the microplastic particle from aquatic or terrestrial land can go into atmosphere through wind transport. And from there, based on rain or snow, it can enter back to our land, terrestrial or aquatic environment again. But when they re-enter, their plastic size will be much smaller because the breakdown process has already happened. So this lifestyle of microplastic is ongoing, never stop in any way. What matters here is the size gets smaller and smaller. That is the main problem here with the lifestyle of microplastic. Okay, and then besides the plastic waste that we produce, there are many other sources that we can relate. One of the sources is sewage treatment plant, wastewater treatment plant, that also another source that contribute to plastic waste in a smaller version. In our case, it's microplastic. Apart from these sources, we have meteorological factor, sunlight, rain, wind, that further break down the plastic. It makes the plastic size much more smaller. And at the end, all these factors make the microplastic to reach seafood, or I believe is the same case of microplastic found in eggs in Surabaya. There's something in this pathway where at the end, we are the human who are going to eat seafood or any food with microplastic in the food. And then there are, obviously, you know, there are many problems that you know, diseases like cancer and so on that can happen to our human health. Okay. Now you must be asking, if you throw a plastic bottle, how the plastic bottle as a waste can become microplastic at the end of the day. So here we have certain characteristic, microplastic characteristic that made differences between each plastic size. Okay, we start with macroplastic. Macroplastic refers to your empty bottle water that you throw away because the size is more than 200 mm or 20 centimeters. But when water break down use through meteorological factors, sunlight, rainfall, the movement of human or any other sort of factors, then the macroplastic, the bottle, plastic bottle will be break down between 5 mm to 200 millimeter. That is actually mesoplastic. And after certain time means 10 to 15 years of mesoplastic in environment, it can break down to microplastic. So in lay term, microplastic is plastic that less than 5 millimeter or 0.5 centimeter. This is the size of microplastic. So from today, if you heard microplastic, you know the size. The size is less than 5 millimeter up to 1 micrometer. That is microplastic. Okay. And now a few of Europe countries, they have found nanoplastic, which is less than 1 micrometer being found. So the detection of nanoplastic shows how dangerous is the breakdown of the plastic that happened in environment. And this is too small, which definitely can enter food. And at the end of the day, it enters our human body through food consumption. Okay, first we see size. Now we see shape. Okay, the size, you know, it is less than 5 millimeter is called microplastic. In terms of shape, it has various shapes. We go a simple way of understanding shapes. It starts with granular or beads. It's in a round shape, circle shape. That is called, if they say granular, is the same thing with beads in a circle shape, which mostly comes from personal care products. Personal care products can be your toothpaste, facial scrub, facial cleanser, and whatsoever. Next is fiber. Fiber, you know the shape is in a small, tiny, linear form, okay, that is fiber, and most of this microplastic shape comes from synthetic textile fiber, okay. And then we do have other shapes like fragments, okay, breakdown of plastic waste, like bottles, plastic toys, and whatsoever. Normally, they'll break down into fragments, the small pieces. Film is a tiny layer that is called a film. That's the difference between shape. Okay. This is a better representation of the shapes. If you can see, you can clearly see a line is another way of saying for fiber. You have film, the tiny thin layer, and then you have pellets or beads or micro beads. Granular, all same thing. It's a circle shape. You have fragments. Okay, if you go to aquatic environment today or beach, you will find most of the plastic microplastics are in fragment because it's a breakdown from macroplastic to microplastic. So these are a better way of understanding in terms of its shape. Okay, now we move on to type. Okay, you have learned size, you have learned shape. Now you will learn type. If you look at microplastic can come from two types. One is the primary, the second one is secondary. Okay, we go to primary first. Primary microplastic, these are the four main sources you have from plastic pellets, the small circle pellets that used in industrial. You do have from industrial abrasive or 3D printing powders that can contribute directly the microplastic to environment. You do have from personal care product. In residential area, primary microplastics are related to personal care product. I'll be sharing some findings later that will help you to understand better. So all this primary microplastic, it enters either to wastewater treatment or directly to your water bodies. Okay, if you see in Malaysian setting, personal care product, because our topic is in residential area, now most of personal care product, when I use toothpaste or facial wash, facial scrub, whatever related with personal care. It includes cosmetics. There are some scrubs being used in certain cosmetics. So in Malaysia, more than 97% it goes to wastewater treatment plant and sewage treatment plant. Yeah, the same thing. In wastewater treatment plant, because of its technology, it could not remove everything. There are certain microplastic cannot be removed and it goes to water bodies. The one that can be removed, it goes to sludge. Okay. Sludge, in Malaysian setting, we don't use sludge as a fertilizer in agriculture soil. But if you see countries like China, Sweden, they use sludge as a fertilizer in their agriculture soil. So what happened is their agriculture soil, their soil contains a number of microplastic and the source is related with sludge application. But in Malaysia, we don't do that. But I would like to ask the audience about Indonesia. What happened to the wastewater treatment plant and the technology? Is there a tendency microplastic escape to water bodies? Anybody can contribute certain opinion? Is there a chance microplastic from wastewater enter water body? Anyone? Or you are not sure?
Bagaimana teman-teman? Ibu Pravina bertanya, apakah ada kemungkinan dari air limbah yang sudah mengandung plastik juga masuk ke dalam badan air kita, nah, yang biasa kita gunakan untuk kegiatan sehari-hari. Mungkin ada yang mau berpendapat?
Oke.
Okay. Ada hello.
Ya, silakan.
Yes. My name is Aulia from Faculty of Public Health University of Indonesia. So I just want to add additional information that I know about plastic waste in wastewater in Indonesia. As from what I know, a lot of plastic waste come from domestic wastewater treatment. As you can see, there's a lot of river in Indonesia that have a lot of plastic waste, and sadly there is a systematic intervention that reducing plastic in rivers. So that's why I think the biggest search is from domestic and maybe from some people that living near the river. Yes.
Thank you so much.
Terima kasih, Aulia.
Yes. So meaning to say almost majority of developing countries, it's a direct discharge from domestic to aquatic. We have the similar problem as well. Okay, so that's why we can find microplastics in water bodies, not only from wastewater, but also from domestic waste. Thank you so much, Aulia. Okay, so we move on, yeah? Okay, here, because of that, we have quite serious problem where the microplastic has been made as a story for us to understand how dangerous it is when it enters aquatic environment. And this is one of the story that been shared widely in social media, where breakup of microplastic at the end of the day, when it enters aquatic, it's another dangerous thing to not only to human, but also to aquatic animals. Okay, now we are moving on to our topic, residential area. When we talk microplastic pollution in residential area, these are few of the sources that we can relate to ourselves. Number one, you try to think your toothpaste today, how much you have used today to wash, to brush your teeth. That could be one of the contributor. Okay. The second is from our washing machine, our domestic washing. could be another source. These are two main source in residential area. If you can do something or you would like to do something today to reduce microplastic pollution, target these two. Go for a safe toothpaste or a facial wash without microbeads, and wash all these synthetic textiles by hand. I know it's a bit difficult, but that's two of the way to manage microplastic pollution in residential areas. So all this, your toothpaste, your facial scrub, your shower gel, all these are from primary sources. It enters directly from us to wastewater or aquatic environment. Okay, whereas there are secondary microplastic sources where you do have domestic waste, like your bottled water, children toys, your tire, your car vehicle tire, and so on. This plastic waste will break down to certain sizes, and then it will form microplastic. So I'll be covering a few of findings from what we have done so far, focusing on residential area, and we will see whether you know or without your knowledge, we are contributing to microplastic pollution. The first case study is from our personal care and cosmetic product. This is 2018 paper. Okay, 2018 paper. Okay, so this research is about we have done a survey involving 214 respondents, and we obtained 10 personal care products. It includes 14 brand of toothpaste and 25 brand of facial cleanser and scrub. Okay, here, this is the data where most of them, of course, everybody use toothpaste, you see. So I don't know the type of toothpaste in Indonesia, but in Malaysia, the well-known is Colgate, obviously, and we do have homemade toothpaste also being marketed now. So we have selected toothpaste and facial cleanser and scrub as a product to be analyzed. Okay, so what happened is these are all the sample with certain shape. You remember just now I've explained to you the shape. Granula means the circle one. Most of microplastics in personal care products, facial cleanser, toothpaste, they will use microplastic in circle shape, granula. Okay, I believe that's suitable for personal care and gives a better cleaning effect rather than other microplastic shapes. Okay, these are certain photos in facial scrub. Of course, I cannot tell you the product, but you see, it's in a granula shape and it's colorful. Why they added a colorful one? That's a marketing purpose. You'll be excited to see some colorful rather than colorless, right? Okay, that's normal. Okay, you see, this is one of from one of the facial scrub. When we analyze the type of plastic polymer, what we obtained was polyethylene, low density polyethylene, the same material of our plastic bottle, PET. Okay, this is in one of the facial scrubs. All right, and then this is another facial scrub, the same thing, PET, polyethylene. Okay, just now the microplastics in circle shape are with color, okay, green, red, and etc. This is colorless. Even with the colorless, you do found microplastic were detected. If you see 90.79% is actually PET. Even without color, the microbeads or microplastic being added in the facial scrub. Okay, this is toothpaste. Although it's colorful, I think all of us can see some blue thing in our toothpaste. Although it's with color, okay, blue color, very nice blue color. But when we analyze FPIR to detect the which type of plastic being used, there is no any plastic being used in toothpaste. Okay, this fluoroethanol is actually a fluoride related component in our toothpaste. I believe that it's for our fluoride thing, fluoride that related to teeth, bones, and whatsoever. But it is not a microplastic. So most of this microplastic, the one that been related in personal care products are from facial scrub. Most of toothpaste or most of them, compared to all the toothpaste product that we analyze, only one where we have found low density polyethylene, LDPE, related with toothpaste. But if you look at facial scrub with granular shape, almost all has a low density polyethylene, LDPE. This can be related with our bottled water. Okay, these are some of the product which I'm not supposed to tell the brand, but if you see this product, you can see the component and try to search which of this ingredient or composition is actually microplastic. It is a bit difficult to know which of this component is actually microplastic. You need to really understand the component. Okay, I'll teach you how to detect that shortly. So moving on from this research, the total of microbeads emission when we use toothpaste or facial scrub annually in a year, there are total of 0.199 trillion microbeads that enters wastewater. And we know wastewater cannot remove everything. So at the end, all these trillion microbeads will enter environment. Okay. This product, Neutrogena and I'm not sure the brand, but Neutrogena, I'm very sure they have written that their facial scrub actually contain microbeads with polyethylene composition. So what happened when there is a movement to stop use microplastic in personal care product? Neutrogena has stopped the use of microplastic. So there is no more polyethylene or microplastic in their product. They have changed to a safer product now, okay? And I was also aware that Indonesia has taken a step to stop microplastic personal care products that has microplastic. I'm not sure what are the product, but that's what I've read so far. Yeah. Okay. We move on to next slide. From there, Okay. From there, we will move on to Neutrogena. Okay, now since you are at home, we would like to do this activity. Can you bring your personal facial cleanser or scrub? so that we will learn today whether your facial cleanser or scrub has microplastic. Can you do that? Boleh bawa?
Okay, teman-teman di sini yang bisa ikut aktivitasnya bisa lakukan ambil facial scrub, sabun muka kalian, terus kita coba lihat komposisinya sama-sama di sini.
Boleh?
Okay, I think I'll try to bring mine too.
Yes, yes, please.
Okay, teman-teman yang lain, Bapak Ibu dosen juga kita bisa okay. Coba belajar sama-sama.
Yeah. In 2 minutes, can you all bring? Okay, we are here, 29.
Oke, dipersilakan kepada para partisipan untuk ikut serta. Kalau nya ada di dekatnya sabun muka bisa diambil dulu. Kita coba pelajari jenis mikroplastik apa yang ada di
produknya
kita.
Okay, how many we have? Okay, your job now is to check the ingredients. Do you have any ingredients in your facial scrub that you suspect these are microplastics? Your job is to check. Okay, and then I'm sharing a link here. You can go to this link. Okay, and share your facial cleanser photo so that we will learn whether your product has microplastics or not. Okay, as a start, can any one of you share your screen to show your product so that we will learn?
Teman-teman di sini. Okay, I'll start. I'll start.
Okay. Yes. Can you show your product, please?
Okay. So how I'm gonna share it to you?
Yes.
Sorry, I have to open the Miro web first, right? These are my screen now. Am I in the right position?
Let me see it.
Is my screen appear now?
No, it's still in the Miro thing. the in.
Oh, I think I just I will stop and try to find the information about the product first.
Okay, all right. Yeah, send the second link if you can. Yeah, the second link. Can you try?
Okay.
Okay. And anybody else, if you want to share or just show your product so we can also try to see. I can see somebody moving the cursor. Anna. Yes, Anna. Okay. Nanda, Inas. Yes, yes. There are a few of them. Okay, you can edit. You can edit. You write your name. Okay, you write your name. Yes, I can see. Ah, yes, Azmi, you are in.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. The rest? Please come and write your name, upload your personal care product photo. Okay, and upload your personal care product photo, and you can write any of your suspected ingredients.
Okay, I just wrote the whole ingredients. Okay, sejauh ini ada 7 orang peserta. Mungkin partisipan yang lain juga bisa ikut serta dengan masuk ke link yang kedua dari yang diberikan oleh Bu Pravina tadi.
Okay, person who have entered the ingredients, can you write the number? Oh, that's you, Azmi?
Okay.
Yeah, the person who have typed that, can you please type your name?
Oh, okay. Okay, semakin banyak teman-teman bisa sambil menuliskan namanya, produknya apa, dan juga mungkin kira-kira yang termasuk dalam mikroplastik dalam bahan yang di dalam sabun muka yang digunakan oleh teman-teman bisa kita coba tuliskan di tempat. Okay, in my special was there is written acrylate copolymer. Is that one of a kind of the microplastic, Ms. Arun? Okay, teman-teman bisa terus mendiskan informasi apa saja yang ditemukan. Ini kita juga melihat Pak Sudarmaji juga ikut membuat sepertinya ini.
Okay, I'm back.
Okay.
All right. So I've seen almost all. Yeah, some are still typing. Okay. Right.
Got it.
We give another 2 minutes to go, and then we start our. Right. Okay, so we are here. Okay, can we continue? Okay.
Okay, I think we all can.
Right. Yeah. So now you have seen your facial cleanser or scrub or whatever product that you have brought. Can you check whether you have these ingredients, polyethylene, polypropylene, polymethyl methacrylate, nylon polyethylene, and acrylate copolymer? Do you have that?
I think I have that.
Yes, I've seen your suspected ingredient. Okay, the rest, yang lain, anybody wants to give opinion?
Yang lain, tadi sudah melihat komposisi dari produknya. Coba lihat ke sini lagi ke dari presentasinya besar Papravina. Kira-kira adakah nama yang serupa? Seperti yang ada di layar sekarang. Let's see.
Is there anything in chat? Okay. All right. If you feel shy, it's okay. You can write in that Miro bot. Okay. Now, these are the list of microplastics besides this component, PE, PP, PMMA, PA, acrylate, copolymer, nylon, and whatsoever. Okay, these are the famous one, the very famous microplastic. But there are the shy microplastic people. These are the names. Okay, So what happened is in cosmetic industry, they don't want to write the famous one because everybody know the name. So they go for the shy microplastic we call here. So they write this name so that there won't be issue of microbeads in in their cosmetic product. Okay, so these are the other microplastic ingredient. If you have these names, you are contributing to microplastic pollution. Throw away your facial cleanser or scrub because there are microplastic being released here. Okay. Do write your component, check your component so that we will know whether, in a way, maybe before this, you don't know that you are contributing to microplastic pollution. Now you already know, okay, there are component, these ingredients in your personal care products. Your next job is entirely in your hand, whether you want to change your product or you want to continue to use. Okay, the effect. You can see the effect not now, but in 10 to 15 years later when your microbeads or microplastic further break down, it break down to a smaller portion, then it could be another problem in our country. Okay, so everybody clear about this? Any questions? Any questions? Okay, now I'm sharing another link for you to answer. We will see whether you are the main person you are the person who's contributing to microplastic or not. Okay, this is just as a no blaming, just as a activity. All of us will understand about personal care and toothpaste. Okay, you go to the next link and answer, we see. How many of us are using, how many of us are using problematic personal care products? Okay, I admit before I do the research, I use a product with microplastic. Okay, my product is somewhere in facial scrub in that PDF paper. So when I know, I stop and I use a safer one, okay? All right.
Teman-teman, dipersilakan untuk voting dari yang sudah kita pelajari tadi. Kita melihat dari produk sabun mukanya kita, apakah mengandung mikroplastik atau tidak, bisa di-vote di link yang baru diberikan oleh itu.
Okay. Open the Mentimeter first. How about the lecturers? Everybody quiet? Did you check your products? Prof Farid, Dr. Lilis, Dr. Zida, did you check your products?
Prof Farid tadi ikut ngecek juga, Bu Lilis mungkin. Tadi ada dosen kita juga, Pak Sudarmaji juga ikut menuliskan tadi sepertinya.
May I ask a question, Mr. Azmi or Ms. Sarfa?
Yes, you can.
Okay. Again, my name is Aulia from Faculty of Public Health, University of Indonesia. I have a question regarding the microbeads on our personal care products. I want to ask, do you have any recommendation to change our personal care products, because from what I know, we can using some of the organ from crustacean or shrimp that exchange microbes. So we can use a personal care products, a healthier personal care products, because the ingredients comes from the natural or comes from the animal.
Thank you, Aulia. Okay. First, we don't want to be anti of famous product, famous brand. Okay, your job is to now learn to check the ingredients. Okay, your job is now learn to check the ingredients. You turn around, read the product, and then you go to this Beat the Microbeads website. They have full list of all these microplastic ingredients. If your products with that certain ingredients are not classified as microplastic, then your product is safe. First. Second, if you don't have time, your only aim is to change the product, go for local made product. Most of them don't use all these fancy beads and whatsoever. They are much more safe to be used. You know, now we have homemade soaps. I believe it's the same in Indonesia, with our local herbs, the herbs, leaves and so on. They are much more environmentally friendly, if you ask me. Okay, so the decision is from you and your next step. I cannot force you, or Dr. Zida cannot force you, right? The decision must come from you. You imagine if we stop using this kind of product, you can stop 0.199 trillion microbeads entering wastewater treatment plant. Okay, we take it that way. Okay, now we see what you call that. I am sharing another screen. Yeah, this would. Can you see the website?
Yes, we can see.
Yes, okay. So that's from the Mentimeter. We have 21 participants who have contributed to this survey. Okay, thank you so much. 22 now. Okay, we have 12 of them who have contributed to microplastic pollution from your personal care product. Don't feel bad. It's time to change if you want, or go for most environmental friendly and safer product after this. We have 10 people who they don't have any microplastic in their personal care products. Hey, thanks, and it's a nice thing to see. Okay, I myself changed when I found microplastic. You are better. Okay, all right, we are clear now. Okay, at least you learn something for your personal care products. I am going to go for the next sharing from this thing. Okay. After we finish our personal care product, we go for the next contributor of microplastic in residential area. That's from our washing machine. Okay, our washing machine. Okay, when you look at primary microplastic, you know microplastic has two types. One is primary, one is secondary. We are focusing on primary because in residential area, there are major primary sources that we can relate ourselves. The second one is washing machine. Okay, this is from my student, Melati, who have done her final year project. Okay, this is Melati. Okay, can you see her? Okay, so this research involved questionnaire survey plus take laundry water from their washing machine. So she went, this is before COVID-19, when life was much more better. Okay, so they go each houses, she and her friends go each houses. Can you see the bottle here? After the respondent finished the survey, she will take the laundry water from washing machines. Okay, Now, can you see the filter paper here? Can everybody see the filter paper? Boleh lihat ya? Boleh lihat. Okay. If you see some of the filter paper, they are much more lighter. Okay. And some of them darker. Okay. Right. That in your opinion, okay, what made this filter color different?
Teman-teman, kalau ada yang ingin beropini dari gambar yang sedang kita lihat sekarang, terdapat 3 gambar kertas filter yang mempunyai warna-warna yang berbeda, ada yang lebih terang, ada yang tidak terlalu terang, ada yang sampai gelap. Ada yang ingin beropini, kira-kira apa sih yang bisa menyebabkan filter ini mempunyai warna-warna yang berbeda. And this was taken from three different washing machines, right?
Yes. Three different washing machines. And the first one, that's from Samsung. The second one, I can't see the brand. And the third one, okay. Anybody would like to try? What made this filter different from which washing machine? No one want to try, or you want me to answer? Okay.
Let's get to the answer.
Okay, let's get to the answer. All right. So if you see, the older the washing machine, what you call that? Makin tua, makin lama.
Yeah.
Tua. Tua. Makin tua the washing machine, the filter gets much more darker, sangat gelap. Okay. And this is a new washing machine, baru, atau agak baru, the filter is much more lighter. So it depends if you are using old washing machine and the washing machine washes your clothes and that the washing machine filter could not perform well. So you are going to release quite a lot of synthetic fiber from your clothes. Okay, that's one factor. Okay, let's see another one. Okay, these are all the fibers. If you can still remember the shapes, you have various shapes, right? Fiber, granula, you have fragments. Those shapes, the one that comes from textile is what shape? The one that comes from textile, fiber. Okay, all these are fibers. Okay, what contributes to this synthetic fiber? It's from our clothes. You look at your clothes that you wear. Is it original cotton? You look at it. You give me a second. I'm going to take my t-shirt.
Okay. Para partisipan di sini mungkin bisa melihat contoh dari mungkin pakaian yang sedang dikenakan sekarang.
Ya.
Bahannya entah ada synthetic fabric atau natural fabric.
Natural fabric, yes. Do you have your clothes synthetic or natural cotton or synthetic fabric? Okay, you check your own clothes. Anybody?
Okay.
All right. So before I go on discuss our own clothes, I show the findings so that we will understand better. Okay. So here we have microplastic content is based on weight. We cannot count how many fibers. So we base on the berat. It's the same thing in Indonesia, right?
Yes, berat,
right? Yeah. Yeah. So based on the berat, the filter paper before filtration and after filtration, the laundry water was filtered. So based on the weight, these are the weight that contributes to microplastic content. Okay, you see the size, the length. It is 2258.59 micrometer. Okay, micrometer, and the shapes are fragments and fiber and dominated by fibers. Okay, the fragment here is your laundry soap that could not be soluble in water. Okay, the microplastic polymer, these are the polymer: polyester, nylon, and acrylic. Okay, polyester, nylon, and acrylic. Okay, back to your clothes. If you can identify, polyester is written in your t-shirt. So today when your mother or you are washing in your washing machine, there is a tendency microplastic to be released. Okay, to be released, all right. Now, another finding from Europe indicated the top loading washing machine, okay, were found to be contribute 7 times more microplastic. These are the top loading washing machine. Okay, top loading washing machines compared to the front loading washing machine. So the top loading one contributes 7 times more microplastic. That's number one. Number two, clothes segregation, dividing clothes. I know it's impossible. It's also impossible for me to divide the clothes and wash. That's 7 times more work than throwing everything in washing machine. I think the ladies will understand the difficulties of washing separately. Okay, so another way is to hand wash all the clothes with this characteristic: polyester, nylon, acrylates. If you hand wash, that can reduce microplastics release from your clothes. If you ask me, the best way is to wear cotton clothes, but how many of us will only wear cotton clothes? You know, we do have other type of clothes. Okay. However, there are inconsistent findings with effect of detergent. We are still not sure whether detergent can release microplastic from clothes. What is sure is top loading can release microplastic 7 times. The mechanical shake. Remember, we have our washing duration. You set in your washing machine 10 to 20, 21 to 40 or 60 minutes. That also influences the microplastic release, but we are not sure about the detergent. Further research need to be done in that. Okay, so here is another sharing from microplastic in textiles research. Fabric that creates microplastic, these are the fabrics. Okay, again, if you have polyester written in your attire that you wear today, that's the tendency fibers being released. And if you see estimated fiber, acrylates release more than polyester. Okay, this is from another study from Marine Pollution Bulletin. Okay, now again, you check your clothes whether tendency microplastic to be released or not. Okay, so the answer is okay. Silakan. Okay, I think we are running out of time. I will just have a simple survey from here. Anybody wants to answer? What type of clothes are you wearing today?
Okay, I'll start.
Okay, you will start. Okay, ask me.
Okay, so I found that it's a mix of polyester, 65%, and cotton at 35%.
Okay. All right. So if you wash it in washing machine, there is a tendency synthetic fibers to be released. Okay. Thank you, Azmi. Anybody else? Anybody else?
Para participant, ada yang ingin menyampaikan jenis bahan pakaiannya yang sekarang sedang digunakan?
Dr. Lilis, we ask Dr. Lilis now.
Yes, okay.
Dr. Lilis, you think?
Yeah. 100% cartoon.
Wow, fantastic. Wow, okay, I'm wearing nylon. Okay, there's a tendency microplastic to be released. Okay, the rest?
Amita, Indah Sitomurni, disilakan.
Yeah. I wear t-shirt with 66% cotton, but the rest is polyester.
Yes. That the type of clothes. Now, when we wash, we put everything in, so that's why more microplastic release from washing machine. Okay, thank you everyone. So I am now going, this is the last slide for your information. Do you contribute to microplastic pollution in residential area? Do you think you contribute? We ask, Azmi again. Just because you are a moderator.
Yeah, I think I contribute more than I expected.
Okay, all right. Okay, do you think you can manage after this?
Okay.
Certain steps.
We will try.
Oh, we will try, okay. Okay, anybody else would like to have a say?
Can I speak again, Miss?
Yes, please.
Yeah. For my residential areas, I have bank sampah, so we try to separate our waste, and then I think just it for now. But I also developed an application for recycle waste in market, so I hope it's counted as my contribution to my residential areas.
Okay, so thank you, Aulia, for that. Okay, the segregation waste. Yes, that's truly one step to also manage microplastic pollution, because when your waste reaches landfill, you don't know what happened to the waste, right? So this is another way to control. Okay, anybody else that we can ask? Azmi?
Mungkin ada partisipan di sini yang mau menyuarakan jawabannya dari dua pertanyaan yang ada di layar. Melihat dari produk perawatan yang kita gunakan, pakaian yang kita pakai, apakah kita berperan dalam penambahan polusi mikroplastik di daerah kita? Dan juga apakah kita bisa untuk mengatasi dari polusi tersebut. Oke. Mungkin Bu Lilis mungkin.
Asmi, tapi jawaban saya kan 100% kartun ya Asmi ya, yang untuk saat ini loh ya.
Iya, tapi di lemari yang lain.
Kalau di lemarinya masih banyak, Asmi. Yang ditanyakan tadi kan yang sedang dipakai ya.
Iya.
Ya mengurangi, Asmi. Mengurangi ininya, mengurangi apa. Kalau yang di lemari kan jarang dipakai ya. Jadi kan nggak dicuci, nggak ini. Jadi nggak. Yang sering dipakai yang 100% katun, Asmi.
Asli.
Wah. Admire of the release, 100% cotton.
Okay, Terry, silakan.
Oh yeah, I think I do contribute in microplastic pollution in residential areas, and how I manage the microplastic pollution is to first step I would like to change my face wash because from the last one it contains microplastic, and I will influence my family to try watch and select their face wash or their toothpaste so that there's no microplastic pollution. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes. Besides you learning this, it's also important to teach your family members, teach your sisters, brothers, parents. Yeah, it's a very nice step. Okay, one more last participant before we end this lecture. Anybody else? Anyone? Everybody is so shy.
Oke, silakan satu-satu orang saja.
We don't have anybody to contribute to tell. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
All right. Okay. So I hope all the rest who is a bit shy to talk, it's okay. As long as you know that, you know, whether your personal care product is capable to release microplastic, the next step is do what like Willie and Azmi wants to do, that change to a safe product. The first step is check the ingredients. If you want to use product B, check the ingredients and decide yourself. That's the best way. The second way is to wear clothes 100% cotton like Dr. Lily's. That's the best way. She doesn't have to think about segregating clothes in washing machine. Like people like us, we have to think twice or hand wash them. These are certain things. And as Aulia said, segregate your waste so that you know your waste is being segregated and the plastic one being sent to recycle. That's another way to manage your microplastic pollution, because whatever waste that we throw today, the microplastic pollution can only appears after 10 to 15 years because of the breakdown of the plastic from macroplastic to microplastic. I think that's the end of this lecture.
Excuse me, Miss.
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you very much for your sharing. I think very interesting. Thank you very much. But I want to ask about how the microplastic affect to health. And what is the threshold, and which organ are affected? Okay, right. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Okay. How microplastic affect to the health? It depends certain factors. Number one, what type of plastic additive being added? Okay, one of the additive that we have investigated so far is phthalates. What are type of plastic additive being added? Phthalates are one of the. If you see children toys, if you can ban the plastic, that means phthalates being added in that plastic, because children loves to ban the toys. Okay, and another one is BPA, the very famous being related with plastic usage, or when you have hot stuff being added into plastic materials. Okay, so the effect of microplastic, the effect of plastics to human entirely depends on what type of additive being added in plastic products. Those the important key point that you will need to know. So each and every additive has the effect to human health. But if you ask entirely, if say you have taken fish with microplastic inside the fish and you cook the fish and you add it, the entire effect is still unknown. There are still investigation being done. On the other hand, if you want to know the individual effect, what you have to do is you have to go and search what type of additive being added. And from that additive, you can get some answers. The very direct one, they say cancer, but what type of additive can give you cancer? You need to know the type of additive first before understanding the human health effect entirely. I hope I answered your questions just now.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Okay, any other questions?
Okay, we move on to Q&A. Dipersilakan. Kalau nya malu untuk berbicara bisa tulis di chat. Kalau kalau ingin berbicara langsung bisa raise hand. Dipersilakan.
Okay. Any other?
Not yet. Maybe I'll ask first.
Oh yes, please.
Okay. So from the activity that we did, what intrigued me is that many of the products, the personal care products, is marketed as the natural one, is actually still have a microplastic inside it.
Sorry. Can you repeat, please?
Okay, check. Is it clear? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so many of the products that was marketed as a natural products still have the ingredients of microplastic inside it. So is it a bring us to a little bit of bias to how we choose our product, because actually I bought mine because it's from a natural ingredients, but it shocked me that it has a microplastic inside.
Yes, another way to go is you need a product that being approved by a certain authorization body. In Malaysia, it's Ministry of Health. We do have pharmaceutical division that approves certain product. When they approve certain product, the requirement is to state the ingredient. So that's another way. But if you use products that it is does not been approved or no ingredients being stated, then comes certain issues, like, you know, just now you said your own product has microplastic inside. Okay, for your information, microplastic can be in solid, can be in liquid.
Yeah, that shocked me as well.
Yes. So the one that maybe your product don't have beads, but the microplastic is actually in solution, liquid form. It can be as well. Yeah, it can be as well. That's happened to our hand sanitizers. Many of our hand sanitizers, there are liquid microplastic in liquid form being added. This is another issue. So if you want to go to and buy homemade or natural product, you must really ask them the ingredients. That's one. Number two, use local made product that being approved. We will never know what the ingredient. So if it is approved, they need to state the ingredients. That could be another way to use safe product. Because here, you are not only using environmentally product to environment, but you are also using safe product for your skin. That, when your skin is exposed to plastics, every day, you just imagine what will happen in future. You are also making yourself healthy along with environmentally friendly product. Okay, Azmi, right? Okay.
Thank you so much. Next question from Pak Sudarmaji. Mungkin mau bertanya langsung, tapi ini ada pertanyaannya di chat. Do biodegradable plastics and other plastics have the same contribution to microplastic pollution?
Okay, very interesting question. Biodegradable plastic, if the biodegradable plastic still uses plastic additives, then there's a tendency it going to contribute to microplastic pollution. This biodegradable plastic, if you read a bit more, there is a tendency they still use certain percentage of plastic additives. That's to make the plastic soft or can bend
or last longer whatsoever. If there is no plastic additive being used, then it's considered safe. But if there is, then it could be the same thing like Azmi's product where microplastic in a liquid form being added. Those are the things. I'm not sure the ingredients being used in biodegradable plastic. We need to go and check if in a liquid form, microplastic related with liquid form being used, then it contributes to microplastic pollution. It's the same thing like the hand sanitizer that I told you. Hand sanitizer, there is no solid product being added, but in a liquid form. So in a way, when you wash your hand or when you apply hand sanitizer, there's a tendency in a liquid form. You are contributing microplastic in a liquid form when you wash your hand or whatsoever. Okay, this is about biodegradable plastic. You need to check the ingredient. Okay, so microplastic pollution, not only in solid waste, in a solid form, it can be also present in a liquid way. Okay, in a liquid way. And this is what, when they found out about microplastic in hand sanitizer, where the liquids in they use in a liquid form. Okay?
Okay. Pak Sudarmaji, mungkin ada tanggapan?
Cukup, Mas. Cukup. Terima kasih.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Miss Revan.
Thank you, Prof.
Mungkin ada peserta yang lain ingin bertanya? Dipersilakan. We still have 5 more minutes. Dipersilakan. Okay, Stevie, silakan.
Thank you. Miss, I need more explanation about how a duration of washing machine can affect the amount of microplastic release from our clothes. Maybe it's because the when the machine spinning or the water spin or something like that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Willie. When the duration, yeah? If I set my washing to 20 minutes, the mechanical shaking of washing is 20 minutes. So the mechanical shaking between the water, detergent, and my clothes is just 20 minutes. Compared to if I set to 45 minutes, so the shaking will be 45 minutes. So that's why the longer the washing, that influences the fiber from here to be released because my shaking is longer, 45 minutes longer than 20 minutes washing setting time. Okay, that's number one. Number two, if your the way of the movement during washing, each washing machine has their different way of movement. That's also influences. So what they found is the top loading machine shakes more than the front loading. That's what they found from Europe. I do believe our washing machines are not similar to the Europe one. In Asian perspective, I think the research still need to be further investigated, our type of washing machine. But the finding that I've shared before is from Europe, the top and the front. So the study indicated the top shakes more because the top one consume more water. So you have more water, the shaking frequency is more than the front one. The front one consume less water. That's the indicated and summarized study from Europe. But for Asian setting, I do believe we need further investigation. Right. Okay.
Yes. Thank you, Miss.
Okay.
Okay. Any other question?
Okay.
Okay. perspective from the chat, one of the participants asked about your contact number or email. Yeah, maybe you can write it down.
I give my email. Okay, all right. It's done for Miss Nida Sophia. That's my email. All right. Any other questions?
Any other questions? To we still have a little bit time. We can stretch that. Okay. Ah, from Aulia Salmatina. Do you have any technology recommendation for reducing microplastic exposed to oil or water?
Do I have any? Do you have any?
Oh, soil. Okay.
Soil. Oh, we both read oil exposed to soil or water. Any technology recommendation to this? No. So far, what I've came across is they invented certain products to remove synthetic fiber from laundry water. However, the performance is very poor. They do have technology to reduce synthetic fiber from laundry water. Just now, the findings, right? However, the performance is a bit poor. But from microplastic exposed to soil or water, there are few studies on activated carbon, carbon to remove microplastic, which I believe specifically for drinking water. Carbon showed a good performance to reduce microplastic for drinking water. But from soil, I haven't came across so far. Or maybe I did not read in recent time, but I'm not sure from soil, but from water, microplastic in water, the carbon, activated carbon that used in filtered machines, that has showed some performance on reducing microplastic. If you see microplastic in water, the concentrations are not that high versus with microplastic in laundry water. That's another way to go. But is there any action that have taken by the government in combating this issue? If I remember, there's an action of reducing plastic waste that being introduced. But in personal care products, I think we are still haven't do anything that's which needs further action. But in plastic waste, there's a drastic action by certain ministries in Malaysia, which I believe that indirectly will help microplastic pollution. I think I answered you, Dr. Yu Yong Gong. All right. Dr. Nida Sophia, what is the probability of oxoplastic? I'm not sure what is oxoplastic. If you can explain.
Plastic is added with oxygen, so degradable to be faster maybe. But it can be to be fragmentation or it can to be mineralization.
Okay. Again, in my personal view, if it these plastics, there is a tendency to break down to from plastic waste to macro and microplastic, then there is a tendency, but the probability, I'm not really sure the probability of it. But if it is plastic that can break down, capable to break down to smaller size, then there's a tendency it become microplastic. But the duration, I'm not so sure, Dr. Nida Sophia. The probability, I'm not sure.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so oxoplastic is the same as a biodegradable plastic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, biodegradable plastic.
Okay. Maybe that was the last question. Okay. I would like to thanks to Bu Sarva Manggala Pravina for your time, for your presentation, for your sharing as a today's lecture. And mungkin untuk kesimpulannya saya tuliskan saja dalam bahasa Indonesia. Mikroplastik sendiri dimulai dari berbagai macam jenis, yang mana di negara-negara seperti Indonesia, Malaysia, terkadang untuk pembuangan plastik sendiri masih dibuang langsung ke sungai atau ke badan air, yang mana itu selain mikroplastik yang berbahaya, juga bahkan plastiknya pun sendiri juga masih mencemari di dua negara kita ini. Untuk di daerah-daerah pemukiman, beberapa yang utama dalam memberikan kontribusi dalam polusi plastik adalah PCP, personal care products, dan juga penggunaan mesin cuci atau washing machine, yang mana kedua hal tersebut masih kita bisa minimalisir dengan menggunakan personal care products dengan bahan yang lebih aman. Dan untuk yang washing machine bisa, apabila masih menggunakan top loading, bisa mengganti dengan front loading, atau yang lebih sederhana solusinya adalah cuci dengan tangan. Yang mana untuk di daerah pemukiman sendiri, primary waste-nya berasal dari dua kegiatan itu, secondary waste-nya masih banyak lagi yang merupakan hasil dari kegiatan-kegiatan kita sehari-hari. Nah, maka dari itu sangat penting untuk kita yang mempunyai informasi ini bisa mengajari, bisa memberitahukan kepada keluarga kita, teman-teman kita, orang-orang di sekitar, untuk sekiranya lebih peduli terhadap permasalahan dari mikroplastik ini. Kiranya itu yang bisa saya simpulkan. Demikian berakhirlah sesi kita hari ini. I would like to say thank you to Ms. Sarva Manggala Pravina. Let's give her appreciation of applause. Okay. Saya selaku moderator mengucapkan terima kasih atas partisipasi peserta, dan mohon maaf jika selama berlangsungnya pemaparan materi ini terdapat kesalahan baik tingkah laku atau tutur kata yang disengaja maupun tidak disengaja. Thank you, and selanjutnya saya kembalikan kepada MC.
Terima kasih kepada Mas Azmi Ma'ruf yang telah memandu jalannya diskusi. Thank you for Azmi Ma'ruf for guiding the discussion. Diingatkan kepada seluruh peserta lecture series untuk mengisi link absensi dan form evaluasi yang sudah di-share di kolom chat, yang nantinya akan digunakan sebagai persyaratan untuk mendapatkan sertifikat dan materi yang akan dikirimkan melalui email masing-masing. Reminder to all of participants, lecture series to fill out the attendance link and evaluation form that has been shared in the chat column, which will be used as requirement to get certificate and material to automatically send via email. Acara selanjutnya adalah penutup. Mari kita akhiri acara ini dengan bersama-sama membaca doa penutup kafaratul majelis. Let's end this event together by reading the closing prayer of kafaratul majelis. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika ashadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilaih.
Alhamdulillah, kita sudah sampai di penghujung acara. Sekali lagi, terima kasih banyak kepada Ms. Pravina untuk materinya yang sangat luar biasa. Terima kasih juga untuk Mas Azmi selaku moderator, dan juga Bapak-Ibu dosen dan juga peserta yang telah mengikuti lecture series hari ini dari awal hingga akhir. Semoga informasi dan ilmu yang kita dapat pada series kali ini tentang mikroplastik dapat kita gunakan dan kita aplikasikan. Alhamdulillah, we have reached the end of the lecture series. Thank you to Ms. Pravina and Mas Azmi and all the participants who have listened to this lecture from the beginning until the end.
Hopefully the knowledge we gain today can be useful and we can apply it. Selanjutnya adalah pemberian sertifikat oleh Bu Aziza kepada Ms. Pravena. Kepada yang bertugas, dipersilakan. Next, it's a giving certificate by Mrs. Aziza to our great speaker, Ms. Pravena.
Thank you so much, Dr. Aziza.
Okay. Next one, kepada narasumber, moderator, panitia, dan juga Bapak-Ibu dosen, saya mohon kesediaannya untuk sesi foto bersama. Jadi dimohon untuk menyalakan kameranya dan mengambil pose untuk bisa diambil fotonya. Okay, to the speaker, moderator, and audience, I honorably ask you to take a picture together for today's documentation. So please take your pose and open your camera and don't forget to put a smile on your face. I'm gonna wait for 15 minutes. Okay, I'm gonna take the picture from slide number one. Please hold on until the end of the slide. Okay, slide number two. Slide number three. And slide number four. Okay, saya mewakili panitia yang bertugas menyampaikan mohon maaf apabila ada kata-kata dan perbuatan yang salah atau kurang berkenan. Saya sebagai MC undur diri, sampai jumpa, saya bertemu lagi di acara lecture series selanjutnya. On behalf of the committees of Public Health Airlangga University Summer School, we would like to say thank you to the audience, the lectures, and also our great speaker, Ms. Pravena. Thank you so much for making today's lecture running very well. We do apologize for mistaken, mispronunciation, or inappropriate words and action during this lecture series from the beginning until the end. We look forward to seeing you at the next lecture series. Once again, thank you so much for joining us. Stay safe, stay healthy, and good day. See you later. Terima kasih semuanya. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much. Pravena, thanks for all. Assalamualaikum.
Terima kasih semuanya.
Salam. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih semuanya.
Terima kasih, Kak Ter.
Terima kasih, Bu Lilis.
Terima kasih, Prof. Juliana.
Oh, yes.
Terima kasih, Prof. Juliana.
Prof. Jayati, terima kasih.